I created the impression that climate science is simple. Because there's greenhouse gases in the atmosphere, it is easier for energy to enter the planet than to leave the planet, and therefore it is warmer than it otherwise would have been. And then if we start adding more greenhouse gases to the atmosphere, it would get warmer still. But it is more complicated than that. And I've already given you one of the complications. If air is warmer, it can contain more water vapor. And water vapor is a greenhouse gas, so there is a positive feedback. But the system is more complicated than that. You're looking at a graph of the change in the energy balance since pre-industrial times, since the year 1750. At the very top, we're looking at our greenhouse gases, CO2, and methane, and N2O, all of which have led to a net warming. That is what a positive sign, what a positive number here means. But CFCs are also a greenhouse gas. They lead to net warming, but CFCs destroy ozone. And ozone is also a greenhouse gas, so that is the negative here. Besides these greenhouse gases, we put also a whole lot of other gases into the atmosphere. Some of which have a net warming effect. Some of which may have a net cooling effect. These are short-lived gases, mostly, so their effects are much more regional than global. These gases simply do not live long enough in the atmosphere to spread across the globe. And that, of course, complicates matters. And besides gases, we also put dust in the atmosphere, and that has a net negative effect on the temperature. Again, mostly a regional effect rather than a global effect. And the reason that these dust particles cause cooling is twofold. One, if there's particles in the atmosphere, they actually reflect the sunlight back into outer space, so the heat simply doesn't reach the surface of the planet. But these dust particles also act as cloud condensation nuclei. Essentially, water vapor condenses around these dust particles, and that leads to the formation of clouds. And clouds are actually pretty complicated things. Just think of a summer day when the sky is clear, it's nice and warm. When it's cloudy, it gets cooler. Now contrast that to a winter night. When it's a clear sky, it actually gets pretty cold. And overcast nights are much warmer. So that illustrates that the effects of clouds depend on whether it's day or night, winter or summer. Because clouds do two things. They keep the solar light out, and that makes it cooler, but they also keep the infrared radiation from the Earth in, and that keeps the place warmer. And then it also depends on whether clouds are high or low, light or dark. So clouds are pretty complicated things, and clouds, of course, respond to the temperature of the temperature of the atmosphere. They respond to wind. They respond to the amount of water vapor that is in there. So this is all pretty complicated, but they also respond to the number of dust particles that are in the atmosphere. And people reckon that this has had a net cooling effect. The confidence interval around this central estimate is pretty wide, and that is because clouds are indeed pretty complicated. Story doesn't stop there. There's also changes in the albedo. Albedo is a measure of the reflectivity of the Earth's surface. In summer, it is best to wear light clothes or even white because that reflects the sunlight. If you wear black in summer, you actually absorb a lot of energy, and that makes you hot. The same is true for the Earth's surface. What we have done over the years is replace forests. We've cut them down or burned them and replace them with grassland. Now, if you look at a forest or from a satellite, it's pretty dark. If you look at a forest from an aeroplane, it's pretty dark. But if instead you look at grassland, it is much lighter. And that means that we absorb less energy, and that makes the place cooler. And that explains this net effect. Net negative effect on the temperature of albedo changes. And then finally, of course, the sun is not constant either, but this is a pretty small effect. So the there's all these things going on besides CO2 emissions. Some of it's very uncertain, some of it's a negative, some of it's a positive. Some of it, like clouds and albedo, actually respond to what is going on in the other parts of the climate system. So it is already getting fairly complex. The story doesn't end there, though. This is a cartoon of just one of the gas cycles, the cycle of carbon dioxide in the different parts of the Earth system. And this is a complicated graph, and that's because the situation is quite complicated. So let me tell you what is here. So in the boxes, we have the stocks of CO2 measured in petagrams of carbon. And what you see here is that in pre-industrial times, there was about 590 petagrams of carbon stored in the atmosphere. So that is what the box means, and that is what the black number means. Here we have another black box with black numbers. So there's about somewhere between 173 and 264 petagrams of carbon stored as oil on the ground. Now the red numbers are the changes since pre-industrial times, changes over the last 250 years or so. And what you see is that we've burned around 365 petagrams of carbon over the last 250 years. And that partly explains why the atmospheric concentration has increased from 590 to 590 plus 240, right? So that is what the red numbers mean. And that is what the boxes mean. These are stocks, and these are changes since pre-industrial times. Now the arrows are fluxes, that is how much it changes per year. So the red arrow that you're looking at here corresponds to this 365 here. That is the burning of fossil fuels releases around 8 petagrams of carbon per year into the atmosphere. So the red arrows are again changes since pre-industrial times. There's also black arrows, and these are the natural fluxes, how things were 250 years ago. And what you see is that when plants die back in fall, when trees start losing their leaves, a lot of CO2 is released, about 120. This 120 is much, much more, 120 petagrams of carbon per year, which is much, much more than the 8 petagrams of carbon per year that is released by the burning of fossil fuels. But in spring and summer, when plants spring back to life and leaves get back on the trees, there's a lot of photosynthesis, and of course the photosynthesis takes CO2 out of the atmosphere. And this large natural emission is balanced by photosynthesis that actually sucks a lot of carbon out of the atmosphere. So that is what the black arrows mean here. And then the red is the change since pre-industrial times. And actually what you see is that both arrows have grown, but photosynthesis has grown more. That is, the difference is about 3. That means that around 3 of the petagrams, 3 out of 8 of the petagrams of carbon that we stick into the atmosphere actually disappears into essentially bigger plants. And not all of it ends up in the atmosphere. Similar things are going on in the ocean. Lots, this is a chemical process, essentially the laws of partial pressure. A large outflux of CO2 every year from the ocean, but also a large influx. And again, this has changed. And again, roughly 2.5 petagrams of carbon each year that we emit end up in the ocean. And then, of course, it's transported in the ocean between the surface ocean, the intermediate, and the deep sea. And then, of course, the sediments and the biota. Animals that live in the ocean also have a role to play. So this is all pretty complicated. There's big fluxes of CO2 going on, and those fluxes are actually larger than our emissions, much larger than our emissions. But it should also be clear to you that these things are not independent of the climate. And there's a lot of action here going on in the terrestrial biosphere. And of course, that responds to rainfall and temperature and all those sort of things. So these fluxes here are not independent of the climate. And the same is true for the CO2 exchange in the ocean and the transport of CO2 through the ocean. That's not independent of climate either. So this just mixes up or makes the problem much, much more complicated than what I initially suggested. So what people have done in order to capture all these complexities, and not just the ones that I described, but a lot more, is that they've built complicated, large, complicated models. That used to be called general circulation models, nowadays are called Earth system models, where essentially they try to capture the physics and the chemistry and the biology of all these processes and run these models and simulations. And they take a long time to run, they take a long time to write, and they need to use supercomputers to actually run these models. And these climate models are the second most complicated models built by humans. The most complicated models are models of protein folding, but after that, climate models are the second most complicated thing that humans have ever built. And then, of course, the question is, do we have confidence in these models? Because by now they are so complex that no one person can understand what is going on in these models. We don't have a good theoretical handle or mathematical handle on what these models are doing. And these models have been built over decades by large teams of people. 100, 200, 300 people working on a single model, and it's simply impossible to keep track of everything that is going on. There have been some validation exercises with these models, and you see the results of those here. And again, this is a graph with a lot of information. So let me tell you what is going on here. We've actually seen this particular black line before. This is the observed global mean surface air temperature. So these are observations, and the same is true here. This is just over land. This is the heat of the ocean, and then the same lines for each of the continents and each of the ocean basins. So that is what the black lines mean. Then the pink intervals is where they ran these models. They started these models around the year 1900 and then ran the model to the year, started the model in the year 1910 and then ran the model to the year 2010. And in the pink area, they ran the model with all the things that we think affect the climate included. So all the greenhouse gases and all the aerosols and all the other things that we think could affect the climate changes in suns, volcanoes going off, and so on and so forth. There is a pink area because there's by now around 30 climate models that can do this. And this pink area that you see here reflects the range of outcomes of these 30 or so models. And what you see is that if we do this exercise, if we run the climate models for a century or so without touching them, but including all the things that we think might affect the climate, then you see that the observed warming is bang in the middle. This is not at all a surprise given our knowledge of the climate system. And this is, of course, also a validation of these models. They're not crazy. They roughly reproduce the global pattern over time, but also roughly reproduce the pattern in the over the oceans and over the continents. So that is a good thing. Now in blue, you're looking at the same models, the same exercise, except that now the aerosols and the greenhouse gases, the things that we did to the system, taken out and the system is just basically, the nature is basically kept as it was at the start of the previous century. And then what you see is that you get a different result altogether. And if we focus on this graph here, what you see is that, for the first half of the century, it was hard to say whether the observed warming, and there was a little bit of warming, was because of natural causes or because of human causes. It was hard to say, but actually around the year 19, well, this is 80 or so, the pink and the blue start to separate. And while it's very simple to explain the observed warming with human forcing, it is very difficult to explain the observed warming with from natural causes only. Now, the range that you're looking at here is a range of best guesses, of best simulation with these models. It's not a confidence interval or anything of the sort. So this is not a statistical proof, but it is suggestive that yes, we humans are indeed responsible for the observed warming. So that is one thing you learn from this graph. The second thing you learn from this graph is that these general circulation models or Earth system models, these very, very complex models of the climate system, are not completely crazy, and they have been validated. They do correspond to the observations.